Hey there, chemists. In this lesson, we're going to look at how you can use a combination of three different functional groups under acidic conditions in a multi-component reaction, meaning we have so many different molecules to put together, in what's called a Monnach reaction. This is named after the German chemist Karl Monnach, who was at the University of Berlin in the early 1900s, and this is useful for making a beta-amino ketone. The starting materials are a ketone, an aldehyde, and an amine. We're under acidic conditions, so under acidic conditions we'll actually see some chemistry we've seen before, but it comes together to give us this beta-amino ketone. Remember, beta refers to not the alpha position, but one more away, and there's your amino group, that relative position away from the ketone. So let's see how this happens mechanistically. I'm just going to use these building blocks as an example for our mechanism. Let's start by drawing out that aldehyde. This is just acetaldehyde. And under acidic conditions, an aldehyde plus an amine is going to make an aminium ion. So this is a refresher of aminium chemistry from a few units ago. Remember, you protonate the aldehyde, you get an oxonium, then your amine comes in. I'm going to use ethylamine. Nitrogen attacks the carbonyl, pi bond goes up. You get a new nitrogen-carbon bond. And if you think back to our aminium chemistry days, here's where we would then do a proton transfer. I have a positively charged nitrogen. We can just do an H plus transfer from the spot where we've got more H's to any spot with lone pairs, in this case, the oxygen. And in all likelihood, it happens intermolecularly from a solvent molecule, but I'm just going to show it intra. And this sets us up to form the aminium, where the nitrogen donates a lone pair, kicks out the water molecule, and you get your carbon-nitrogen double bond. Now this could lose an H and just become the imine, but I'm going to leave it right here. These are all reversible steps, because what happens is we do this in the presence of the ketone, and that's how we get to this functional group in the end. What's happening is, on the other side of your flask, meanwhile, it's like a comic book, meanwhile, on the other side of town, you have a ketone that's going to undergo a reverse tautomerization. Remember what tautomerization is. Tautomerization is when you have an enol turn into a ketone. That's reversible. And thermodynamically, the ketone is the more preferential version of those tautomers, which are just isomers. But the equilibrium mixture is always there. So there's always some amount of the enol that's present. And we can show how it forms, still under acidic conditions. Protonate the ketone, you get an oxonium just like up above. And you have some conjugate base around. I'm just going to use water. I mean, we have plenty of bases, including the amines up here. But a conjugate base can take away an alpha hydrogen and turn that oxonium into our enol. This is just the beginning of a reverse tautomerization. Reverse tautomerization. Why did I do that? Well, we're forming a new bond. If you look back at the molecule that we make from this, we have to make a carbon-carbon bond right here. And if I check this piece of our product, that must come from this aminium. Whoops, I'm just noticing I lost an H, didn't I? This used to be an aldehyde, so that aminium came from the aldehyde. There it is. So that aminium right here, that batch of carbons, becomes this batch of carbons. And obviously the ketone becomes this batch of carbons, so we need to make a new carbon-carbon bond right there. That's how enolate chemistry works, but we can't have an enolate present because we are in base. So the acidic version of an enolate is an enol, hence the reverse tautomerization. So we have our enol, and this enol sees our aminium. that we just made from up above. And the enol can act as a nucleophile. The pi bond can attack the aminium carbon, send those pi electrons up to the nitrogen, and at the same time, this oxygen from the enol can come down to form a pi bond. And if I draw what that gets us, there's your new carbon-carbon bond with what used to be the aluminum. Now I have a single bond up to the nitrogen, and I still have the H on the nitrogen, and I still have an ethyl. I'm just going to abbreviate them by writing the formulas. And that's basically the product. All that's left is we have to lose that H. And we can put H's on and take them off all over the place in these acid-catalyzed mechanisms. So anything could take that H away. And then you regenerate the ketone, and now you have a secondary amine, in this case, attached at the beta position. Your beta amino ketone. So it's one big mechanism broken up into two parts, formation of the aminium, and then formation of an enol, and then this part here should look very reminiscent of how enolates, or remember an enolate, would just be the anion of this position, also drawn more commonly in most of our notes as a negative charge on that carbon. But the way it reacts is the same. You have something very electrophilic, and it gets attacked by the alpha carbon of something that's nucleophilic. And that's how you get that key bond right there between the two carbons. So let's look at a couple of examples that just apply this mannic reaction using aldehydes, ketones, and amines. And let's see if we can do these with more abbreviated mechanisms. I'm not going to write out the whole mechanism for each one. I'm just going to try to take some shortcuts because we just want to figure out the product. So to do this, I'm going to look for the aldehyde and the amine, and I'm going to draw what it looks like as a condensed aminium species. So I still have my six-membered ring. I still have this ketone up here. And what's an aminium look like? An aminium is the carbon-nitrogen bond between the nitrogen of the amine, and the carbon of the aldehyde, in this case formaldehyde. And you lose 1H and 1O and get a positively charged aminium. So I'm just going to have that aminium. What happened to these two H's? Oh, they're still there. You don't need to draw those. You know from line structures in chapter zero that those hydrogens are still there. This is just an intermediate, but it sure helps me figure out what the product looks like. The product is formed from the aminium carbon and the alpha carbon of the ketone. I don't need to go through the whole mechanism to draw what that's going to look like. We did it up above, but notice that the ketone just turned back into a ketone in the end anyway. All I care about in terms of what bonds are formed is where those carbons are. So it's between this alpha carbon of the ketone and that aluminium carbon right there below it. And now I can start to see the beginning of this one actually makes a ring. So I have my six-membered ring with a nitrogen in it and fused a five-membered ring with an oxygen at the top right where it was all along. And there's our product from that reaction. Let's do one more together. Here we have two equivalents of an aldehyde, one amine, and a very nice enolizable ketone that has what look like two very good enolizable spots. Not only are those alpha to the ketone, they're in resonance delocalization with the benzene. So if I made an anion, that would be a benzylic anion, and I got two of them that I can eventually get, so I can already predict what's going to happen. So let's see. We're going to first do the same thing we did up above. I've got an aldehyde and an amine. I'll draw the aminium. Actually, I'll draw the ketone unchanged. And then the aminium would have the nitrogen. I would still have a methyl. This is formaldehyde, so it's just a one carbon aldehyde. And then that would be my aminium. The nitrogen, the methyl, and one of the hydrogens are still there. And then there's my aminium. My product would be from the alpha carbon of the ketone to the aminium carbon. Which means I would get a new carbon-carbon bond right there, which is now attached singly to the nitrogen, which still has a methyl and a hydrogen. We're actually not done. This still continues, and I know that because it tells me I have two of these formaldehydes. So once I'm here, we're gonna do it again with a second formaldehyde. So I can make another iminium between that nitrogen and that carbon. I'll redraw the top part of the molecule that hasn't changed. And now my nitrogen is doubly bonded with a plus charge on it, methyl still there. And here I have a second alpha position that can enolize and give me a six-membered ring once I form that carbon-carbon bond. So our product will have my phenols, the ketone that's been there the whole time, and a six-membered ring with a nitrogen. So this is a double monic. Double monic. Okay, so I'll leave those two right there in front of you. I'd like you to hit pause and see if you can figure out what the product would be of the third one. There's the aldehyde, there's the amine, and there's the ketone. What would it look like after you do a manic from that? Okay, let's see how you did. First, let's combine the amine and the aldehyde and make an iminium. I'm gonna draw everything the same and only change what's changed. To get the iminium, I lose that H on the nitrogen, and I get a double bond with a plus charge. Don't forget what's on your aldehyde. This isn't formaldehyde. I have an H and then also a phenyl. I'm gonna leave that H invisible. To get the product, I form a bond between the alpha carbon of the ketone and the aluminum carbon. Wait, there's two alpha carbons to the ketone. How do you know which one? Well, we know from all of our aldols and other cyclization reactions, you want a good ring size. So it's gonna be the one that makes the six-membered ring. Five and six-membered rings, for our purposes, are always going to be more favorable than four-membered rings or seven-membered rings. So if given the choice, you go with a five or six-membered ring. And there's our product. One menic, one aldehyde, one ketone, one amine. Okay, let's just wrap up and let's see how we could use the menic to make a starting material. Let's turn this question around and go backwards. Well, remember the monic makes a beta amino ketone. So let's find where these alpha and beta positions are. They're in between the ketone and the amine of the product. So that's my alpha position and that's my beta position. And that's the bond that gets made in the monic. That's the one that we've been drawing with these dotted lines every time we figure out the product in the forward direction. So going backwards, where did this come from? I'm going to imagine that I made that bond. And what did it used to be? Let's draw a retrosynthesis arrow. Well, I fill in the alpha with hydrogens. And the beta carbon used to be the iminium. That's the bond that I'd be making. So what did this used to be? I gotta go backwards one more. Oh, well, that iminium used to be an aldehyde with that many carbons, just one, and a free amine. So I have my ketone attached to the six-membered ring, a free primary amine, just an NH2 group, and a formaldehyde. So this was partially intramolecular and partially intermolecular. But if I took formaldehyde, that amine, and that ketone, I should get that beta amino ketone. Okay, so it's been a while since we've incorporated nitrogen into our molecules, but finally we're back at doing it with this reaction. Even though this doesn't involve enolate chemistry, it's certainly similar in that we're forming these alpha-beta bonds. And the only difference is we're using the acidic form of an enolate, an enol. That's how you do the monic reaction.